theorem to a conjecture made by a German mathematician long back in 1955, known as Knesser conjecture. And the result was really very good. The conjecture itself was posed in 1955, and it was solved in 1978 by Loise. As you know, Loise is a Nobel laureate, and he came to India during the Hyderabad ICM, International Congress of Mathematicians, and is a high-class mathematician. So he proved this conjecture, and not only he proved this conjecture, in fact, the proof itself, though it was a little complicated at that time, but it was the affirmative proof, and people liked the proof, but it used the sophisticated machinery of algebraic topology. But very soon, another proof was found out by another mathematician. So I will point out all these aspects of this subject, and actually a new subject has grown up. I must tell you that for the last 10 or 15 years, many results have been proved in this area, which are related to Knesser conjecture and the work of Loise, and a new subject has emerged. And the name of the subject is topological combinatorics. And somehow the Bersu-Coulomb theorem is at the base of topological combinatorics. And that's why I decided that I must explain what is Bersu-Coulomb theorem to the beginners. Actually, most of you must be knowing the beginning topology, and maybe even the elementary algebraic topology. But this theorem is really very deep. In fact, there are two theorems which are very, very deep in algebraic topology. One is the so-called Brouwer's fixed point theorem. And this was, of course, proved when the algebraic topology was being invented at that time, in the very beginning. And what it says is that if you take the N disk, as you know, it's a compact Hausdorff space, like two disks, for example, is the usual two disk. One disk is the interval, closed interval. Then you have the three disk, you have the four disk, you have the N disk. So suppose that Dn is the N disk. And there is a continuous mapping, self-map, F from Dn to itself. Then the theorem says that there exists a fixed point of that theorem. This is actually a fixed point theorem.
Sir, have you shared your presentation?
Hello?
Sir?
Yes, not yet.
Oh, okay.
Okay. I'm going to share. Yes, okay. I'm going to share. Just okay. Please wait a minute.
Okay.
So, okay. So maybe I will now open it and then keep talking. Just I will take a few minutes. I am starting. Okay, can you please see this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, if it is visible, then I can now start. So, this was the theorem I was talking about. It's called the Bersu-Coulomb theorem. Actually, S. Coulomb, he posed a problem. And it was Bersu who solved it using algebraic topology, tools of algebraic topology, because by that time, algebraic topology had become a very, very active area. And so the theorem became known as the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. So let me just begin it, and then I will use also the white blackboard sometimes. So the Bursu-Coulomb theorem is one of the most useful tools offered by elementary algebraic topology to the outside world. And here are four reasons why this is such a great theorem. And these reasons are, first of all, this theorem has several different equivalent versions. And each one of these versions is really very attractive and highly geometric. In fact, there are many, many versions, but I will deal only with few versions of this theorem. So it has one of the reasons why this is important. That it has several different equivalent forms. And the other reason is that it also has many different proofs. Because you see, once you have a great theorem, you want to simplify the proof as much as possible. So people tend to get a different proof in some sense, which is easier. So it has lots of proofs, different proofs. And then the third, which is the most important thing, is that it has not only one extension or generalization, it has several. It has many extensions and many generalizations, and they are, all of them are being used in topological combinatorics, which I mentioned. And then the final thing is that it has numerous interesting applications, not one, two, or five, four, five. It has numerous. And as I said, I will be dealing with one of the most interesting applications of this theorem. One of the versions of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, the one that is perhaps the easiest to remember, it states that, now this is the statement, and see, this is the original form. What it says is that if you consider the n sphere, Sn, I'm sure that all of you know, this Sn is the round n sphere. That means it is a subset of r to the power n plus 1, whose equation is x1 squared plus x2 squared plus xn plus 1 whole squared is equal to 1. So it's a round sphere. In sitting in the dimension n plus 1 Euclidean space. So that is our Sn, and Rn is the n dimensional Euclidean space. So the theorem says that you take any continuous map F from Sn to Rn, then there exists a pair of antipodal points x and minus x such that f of x is the same thing as f of minus x. In other words, under the continuous mapping F, a pair of antipodal points of Sn, they are mapped to the same point. I will explain more. Now, it is instructive to compare this with the Brouwer's fixed point theorem, which says that any continuous mapping F from Bn to Bn, Bn means n disk. It has a fixed point, that is, f of x is equal to x for some x belonging to Bn. So these two theorems are related, and I will also let you know how these two theorems are related. Here are some definitions which I must explain. Two points, x1, x2 of the standard n-sphere Sn are said to be antipodal points if they are diametrically opposite to each other. That is, x2 is the same thing as minus x1. So actually here Sn, remember, I am considering the round n-sphere. So if you have any point, you have always a point opposite to that point. That means you consider the diameter passing through that point, then the two endpoints are known as diametrically opposite points. So any two diametrically opposite points are said to be antipodal points. Now remember that the sphere Sn admits a homeomorphism H from Sn to Sn such that h of x is equal to its antipodal point, minus x. And remember that h squared is identity, because the definition is h of x is equal to minus x, so h squared of x will be h of minus x, will be actually x itself. This map defines a natural free action of multiplicative group G, having only two elements on Sn, and this is called antipodal action of on Sn. So now remember, here I must mention, if you consider the circle, then you understand what are the antipodal points very clearly. And therefore, there is a G2 action on circle S2. Similarly, there is a G3 action on the two sphere. which is the actual square that we know. In fact, for every n, we have a Z2 action, and that action is this antipodal action. That means every point going to its antipodal point. So this defines a Z2 action on a sin, and it's called antipodal action. These are some definitions, because I will use them, so I am mentioning. Now, this is simply to tell you that it is possible to generalize this idea. A topological space X which admits a free G action is called an antipodality space. And here G means Z2, the Z2 action. This is actually a repetition, forget it. Okay. The fourth point is a map F. Now, remember, this is something interesting. I am now considering the spheres, M sphere and N sphere. M and N can be of maybe different or maybe same. So any map F from SM to SN is called the antipodal map. It's a very important thing. Now, I am emphasizing that we have to understand this. A map A from SM to SN is called the antipodal map if it preserves the antipodal points. What it means is that F of minus H is equal to minus of Fx for every X in SM. Now, remember, SM has antipodal points, SN has antipodal points, and I'm considering a continuous map F from SM to SN, and we will say that this map is antipodal provided antipodal points of SM, they are mapped to the antipodal points of SN. In other words, for every X in SM, F of minus H is the same thing as minus of Fx, and this is called antipodal map. Okay, now let me use white blackboard and explain something before I proceed further. So, please bear with me, because I will use the Microsoft whiteboard, and because it is free of software, so lots of commercials sometimes creep in. So, be patient, please. Okay, can you see the whiteboard?
Yes, anybody? yes, sir.
Okay, it's visible.
Visible.
Okay, fine. Yes. So you see here, I am drawing a small circle. So suppose that this is S1. See again, this is S1. And then, as you know, we have S2, which is something like this. My handwriting is not very good. So we have here S2. So you have S1, you have S2, and you have S3, and so on and so forth. And now notice this, that S1, this is contained in S2, and this is contained in S3, and so on and so forth. Now here, S1 is the standard circle. X squared plus y squared is equal to 1. And S2 is the standard 2 sphere. X squared plus y squared plus z squared is equal to 1. And as you know, S1 is sitting as in the form of equator to S2. And similarly, S2 is sitting in the form of equator of S3, and so on. These are all natural inclusions. I hope you realize that these natural inclusions, they go on. And as you know, the inclusion maps are continuous. Therefore, I have a mapping from S1 to S2. And notice this mapping, what it does, it takes any point here, say x comma y to x comma y comma 0. That is the standard inclusion. Similarly here, if you consider the mapping xyz going to xyz 0. So these are the natural inclusions from S1 to S2 to S3 and so on. Now notice I am making an important observation. If you consider this inclusion mapping from, for example, from S1 to S2, then this inclusion mapping is antipodal preserving. Why? Because if you take any two points here, x and minus x, See, for example, in this circle, I have a point here, I have a point here, and they are antipodal points. Then if you think them as sitting here, these antipodal points are also antipodal in S2. So the inclusion mapping from S1 to S2 is antipodal preserving. Similarly, the inclusion mapping from S2 to S3 is also antipodal preserving. In general, any lower dimensional sphere is sitting in the higher dimensional sphere, and the inclusion map is antipodal preserving. So you see, you have antipodal maps from here to a natural antipodal map from S1 to S2, from S2 to S3, and so on. And what Ulam asked was this: can you find out a mapping from here to here, backward direction, from S2 to S1, which is antipodal preserving? Can you find out a mapping from S3 to S2, which is antipodal preserving? In other words, the question was, can you find out an antipodal preserving map from a higher dimensional sphere to a lower dimensional sphere? Can you do this? And this was really a very interesting question at that time. And you'll be surprised to know that this question is the same thing as the Bersu-Coulomb theorem. In fact, the answer to this question will be that no, we cannot find out any antipodal mapping from S2 to S1, which is antipodal preserving. We cannot find out any mapping from S3 to S2, continuous mapping, which is antipodal preserving. In other words, from a higher dimensional sphere to a lower dimensional sphere, it is impossible to find out an antipodal preserving continuous map. This is one form of the Bersu-Coulomb theorem. And the other form, which I have told you already, so let me again explain that form. This is my Sn. And here is, see, for example, here is Rn, R to the n. And you have a continuous mapping from here to here, F. And the Bersu-Coulomb theorem says that any continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn. Now notice this is very important. Any continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn, that may be from S1 to R1, S2 to R2, S3 to R3, and so on. Any continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn, I can always find out a pair of antipodal points here and here. And those two points, they go to the same point here in Rn. That is the theorem. Any continuous map always maps a pair of antipodal points of Sn to a single point of Rn. This is the Bersu-Coulomb theorem. And I will explain you that this theorem is really the same thing as saying that there is no antipodal preserving map from Sn to Sn minus 1. So I hope you realize, let me stick to this statement, namely, the Bersu-Coulomb theorem says that any continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn has a pair of antipodal points which go to the same point. Now remember, this Rn is very important. Actually, if you take a Euclidean space less than Rn, then the same question can be asked. Can you have a continuous mapping? Can you say that the Bersu-Coulomb theorem is also true for from Sn to Rn minus 1 or Rn minus 2? And the answer is yes. Why? Because Rn minus 1 is sitting in Rn. You see here, Rn minus 1 is sitting in Rn. Sorry, this actually my handwriting is very bad here. See, slipping. So the theorem is true not only for the continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn, but even for Rn minus 1, Rn minus 2, and so on. Okay, but the theorem is not true if you replace this n by n plus 1. And you would like to know why. The reason is that you see this Rn is sitting in Rn plus 1. It is sitting in Rn plus 1. And if you take a continuous mapping from Sn to Rn plus 1, as follows. Now, Rn plus 1 has, you see, this Sn minus 1, Sn minus 1 sitting here in Rn, but also it has Sn sitting in Rn plus 1. Therefore, you have continuous mapping F, any continuous mapping from Sn to Sn, Sn is sitting in R plus 1. It is actually the identity mapping you take, and then you find that the antipodal points, they go to the antipodal points. It is not true that F maps a pair of antipodal points of Sn to a single point of Rn plus 1. That is not true, because I have a continuous mapping F from Sn to Sn itself, which is sitting in Rn plus 1, namely the identity map, and this doesn't map a pair of antipodal points to a single point. In fact, all the pair of antipodal points go to the antipodal points, and therefore the theorem is not true there. So it is very important to understand that the Borsuk-Ulam theorem is from Sn to Rn only. It can be lower dimensional, but it cannot be higher dimensions. So that is one of the important things. Okay, now I want to convince you why this theorem is true. And here is the reason. You see, consider S1. This is my S1. So forget that. Okay, and consider the real line here. So suppose that this is the real line. Suppose this is R. Here is the origin. So this is the origin. Now, you consider the continuous mapping F. Now, what does the Borsuk-Ulam theorem says here in the case of dimension 1? That means from S1 to R1. What is the theorem? The theorem says that there exists a pair of antipodal points, say this point and this point, and they go to the same point of real line. That is the theorem, what the theorem says. And I'm going to prove this. And so the proof is very simple. Why? Because it uses nothing more than the intermediate value theorem. And once you realize this proof, then you also realize the difficulty of proving this theorem in higher dimensional cases. So here is a very simple proof of this. What I am given is this. I have circle S1 here, and I have the real line. And I have any continuous mapping F from circle to real line. So first, my first claim is this, that this F maps a pair of antipodal points to a single point of real line. This is my claim. See why? Because you take a point X here. Suppose that this is the point X. What I'm claiming is this, that this continuous mapping F maps a pair of antipodal points to a single point here. So assume that this mapping F is also antipodal. Now, if F is antipodal, so I'm going to prove this result, see the Borsuk-Ulam theorem. So first of all, I prove this, that if this F is antipodal map, then it maps a pair of antipodal points to a single point here. Why? Take any point X, and suppose F of X is 0, this point. If F of X is 0, then because F is antipodal, F of minus X, this point, that is also 0. And we are done. We are done means we have found out a pair of antipodal points which go to 0. But suppose F of X is not 0, that we suppose suppose f of x is not zero, so that means it is positive. So you see, f of x is positive somewhere here. Because f of x is positive, and because f is antipodal, therefore f of minus x will be negative. So it will be somewhere here. So f of x is here, and f of minus x is here. So now you think of this mapping f from x to minus x via this arc. And this arc is nothing but a closed interval. So you have a continuous mapping f from this closed interval into the real line, so that one point goes to a positive number and the other point goes to negative number. Therefore, apply the intermediate value theorem. There exists a point here somewhere y, so that f of y goes to zero. And therefore, you have found out a point y, so that y and minus y both goes to zero. And the theorem is proved when f is antipodal. So if f is antipodal, then I have proved the theorem that any two, it always maps a pair of antipodal points to the same point. And now I can prove the general theorem. Suppose now you take any mapping f from Sn, let me erase this and say it again. Suppose you have a mapping f from S1 to real line. And I am only taking now, I am not assuming that f is antipodal anymore. I am only assuming that f is continuous. And I claim that there are a pair of antipodal points of S1 which go to the same point. So what you do is that you define a mapping, this another mapping, namely x going to f of x minus f of minus x. See, my handwriting is very bad here, in fact. So can you see this mapping? The mapping is x going to f of x minus f of minus x. So if you call this mapping as, say, g of x. So gx is a mapping now from Sn to R. And notice that g of minus x is simply f of minus x minus f of minus x. F of minus x minus f of minus minus x means f of x, which is minus of gx. So g of minus x is equal to minus g of x. By simple, this definition tells you that g of minus x is equal to minus g of x. Therefore, gx is antipodal. And therefore, by what I proved earlier, there exists a pair of antipodal points who go to the same point. That means there exists a point x naught such that f of x naught minus f of minus x naught is zero. And this simply means that f of x naught is the same thing as f of minus x naught. That means a pair of antipodal points now goes to a single point. So the Borsuk-Ulam theorem is proved in the case of a circle to R. A very easy proof. Somehow my handwriting is not very good. I may be excused for this. So because I never wrote on this whiteboard, I have been accustomed to the blackboard only. So that's why I am having problem in writing the things clearly. So anyway, I have proved the Borsuk-Ulam theorem for the simple case S1 to R. And this is the simplest case, of course. And now you may ask, what is the proof for the second case, namely from S2 to R2? If you have a continuous mapping from S2 to R2, then can you find out a pair of antipodal points which go to the same point? Now, I must tell you that this proof is not easy. It uses the elementary concept of covering space theory from algebraic topology. And there, if you are familiar, then a proof can be given which makes essential use of covering projections. And actually, in higher dimensional cases, the proof of Borsuk-Ulam theorem makes use of homotopy groups as well as the homology groups and the cohomology groups. In fact, even the cohomology algebra of a topological space is utilized, particularly the cohomology algebra of higher dimensional projective spaces. And using that ideas, one can give a proof of Borsuk-Ulam theorem in the general case. Now, what I'm saying is that proof in the general case is not easy, though this theorem is very powerful, but the proof is not easy. If you want to see the proof of this theorem, I have a book on algebraic topology. It is called Algebraic Topology, a Primer. It is published, I will give you the reference. It is published under the TRIM series of NVHM. And there is an elementary proof of this Bursu-Coulomb theorem, which uses, of course, the Kolmogorov algebra of projective spaces. But very nice geometric proof is given there. And if you are interested in knowing the proof, you may like to see that proof. Okay, now I come back to my presentation. Okay, so I have given the terms that I'm going to use. So remember the antipodal points and the antipodal map. Now here is the big theorem. Actually, as I told you, there are so many versions of this theorem, but I have collected 7 different forms of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, and each one of them is really enjoying because I have used some form of these theorems, not this form, some other form, in the topological combinatorics. I really feel very happy that one must know all the forms of the equivalent forms of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. So, please go on noticing. The first statement is, remember Sn is the round n sphere, Sn minus 1 is again the round n minus 1 sphere, and Sn minus 1 is sitting in Sn as the equator. And the theorem says that you cannot have a continuous antipodal preserving map from Sn to Sn minus 1. This is the theorem. In fact, you cannot have a continuous antipodal preserving map from Sn to any lower dimensional space, Sn minus 1, Sn minus 2, Sn minus 3, and so on. Because once you have to any lower dimensional, then you can find an antipodal preserving map from Sn to Sn minus 1, and that is prohibited because of this Bursu-Coulomb theorem, this version of the theorem. Now, the second form is known as the continuous version of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, and this is the form in which it was invented for the first time. And as you know, I have already proved it for the case n is equal to 1. And the theorem says that for any continuous map of Sn from Sn to Rn, there is a pair of antipodal points x and minus x, such that f of x is the same thing as f of minus x. In other words, you can always find out a pair of antipodal points going to a single point of Rn, always. That is the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, and this is called continuous version, very popular. And you will find the proof of this version only in the book that I have referred. Now, the third is still a very important theorem of algebraic topology, and it has a name because this theorem was discovered in 1933, immediately after Bursu gave a proof using algebraic topology. So this theorem was discovered, and actually they made use of this theorem, and very interesting application of this theorem. And what it says is this. See, try to understand. I will go slowly. Again, consider Sn, the round n sphere, and consider the closed sets f1, f2, fn plus 1. Their number is n plus 1. So you have n plus 1 numbers of closed sets, and suppose that these closed sets, they cover Sn. Then the theorem asserts that some member fi exists which has a pair of antipodal points. let me explain this theorem a little bit because this is very interesting. So I go to the whiteboard, though my handwriting is not good, but even then. Okay, here it is. You consider this circle, and suppose that this is S1. Now, you see, you take a point here, and you take antipodal point here. I want to cover this set by two closed sets, and one simple closed set is this. You see, you start from here, and you come here, and you come here. Take this arc, complete arc. This is a closed set of S1. But remember, it has a pair of antipodal points. And if you take the other closed sets here, that also has a pair of antipodal points. If you take a smaller closed set from here to here, a smaller closed set which does not have a pair of antipodal points, then the other closed set is going to have a pair of antipodal points. So you see, if you want to cover S1 by two closed sets, you can easily see geometrically that one of them must have a pair of antipodal points. It's very easy to see. But then what I'm saying is that it is very easy to see. Actually, it is not easy to see. The reason is that when I say that you cover S1 by two closed sets, then those two closed sets need not necessarily be closed intervals like this, which I have shown here. They can be very complicated. You may have highly disconnected closed sets, one, and the other also highly disconnected closed sets, and covering S1. And for them, it is not clear, really, that if you have two closed sets, then one of them has a pair of antipodal points. It's not very clear. It is only just an example to show you. So a similar case can be also shown here. For example, if you consider this S2, then here also, actually, you consider any three closed sets, F1, F2, and F3. Then my claim is that these three closed sets, if they cover it, one of these closed sets must have a pair of antipodal points, always. And in general, therefore, the Bersukulam theorem, the Lusternik-Sulman theorem says that if you consider Sn and you consider n plus 1 closed sets which cover Sn, then one of those closed sets must admit a pair of antipodal points. So this was the Lusternik-Sulman theorem, the closed version. So now notice this. This is very important. Given any n plus 1 closed sets, F1, F2, Fn plus 1, which cover Sn, there exists some member Fi which has a pair of antipodal points. A very interesting result. That is the third form of the Bersukulam theorem. And now see the fourth form. The fourth form is almost same as the Lusternik-Sulman theorem. What it says is that now that this time you take any n plus 1 open sets, not closed sets. You take any n plus 1 open sets, U1, U2, up to UN plus 1, which cover the standard n-sphere. Then there exists a member UI which has a pair of antipodal points. And this is called open version of the Lusternik-Sulman theorem. And this is again a very important form of the Bersukulam theorem. Now here I want to remark, apparently there is no connection between 2 and 3. You see, 2 says that any continuous mapping from Sn to Rn has a pair of antipodal points which go to the same point. And the third says that if you cover Sn by n plus 1 closed sets, then one of them has a pair of antipodal points. No connection at all. But actually, you will see that they are really equivalent. Not only connection, they are equivalent. And similarly, this third is equivalent to fourth one. That's also true. And you can also see examples of this in lower dimensional cases and then formulate the conjecture and try to prove it. But the proof is not easy. And then again, you see, once you see the closed version and the open version of the Bersukulam theorem, then you may ask yourself that if I cover the Sn by means of sets G1, G2, Gn plus 1, such that either each one of them is a closed set or is an open set. Take such a covering. Take a covering consisting of n plus 1 sets so that each one of them is either a closed set or an open set. Then again, the same result is true. Namely, there exists a GI which has a pair of antipodal points. This is the fifth form of the Bersukulam theorem. Now, see the another form. This is still a very important form. What it says is that there is no continuous mapping from Dn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on the boundary. I will have to again go to the whiteboard to explain this. So here is what it says. You remember, this is my Sn. And this is really the disk Dn plus 1. The inside, including the boundary, is the disk. And the boundary is Sn. Now, consider the lower dimensional situation, namely, I have here Dn, and I have here the boundary is now Sn minus 1, Sn minus 1. So, this is the disk, and this is the boundary Sn minus 1. What the theorem says is this, you see, you consider a mapping F, you consider a mapping F from Dn to Sn minus 1. Sn minus 1 is the boundary. So, you see, think of a continuous mapping which maps the entire disk to the boundary. Now, the theorem is this, that you cannot have, remember, in all these theorems, it's actually existence. So here again, the existence is this, that you cannot have a continuous mapping F from Dn to Sn minus 1, that means from the n disk to its boundary, which is antipodal on the boundary. That means the any point of the boundary is mapped to its antipodal point in the boundary. So, there does not exist any continuous mapping from n disks to Sn minus 1 to its boundary, which is antipodal on the boundary. You cannot have such a continuous mapping. That is the other version of the Bersukulam theorem and very important in applications. And actually, I must tell you that you never know which form of the Bersukulam theorem is going to be useful for you while you are going to apply this result, because it all depends on the problem that you are tackling. If the problem can be formulated in such a manner that one of the versions, any version, is helpful, you use that version. So remember this statement also. From the n disk to the n minus 1 sphere, which is its boundary, you cannot have a continuous mapping which is antipodal on the boundary. And this is called antipodal on boundary version. And then finally, I have the last one, namely the seventh one. What it says is that if you consider the antipodal mapping from SN to RN, then there exists a point X of SN which goes to zero. Now, this actually, if you remember the S1 version which I proved to you, this was the first thing which I proved. That any mapping F from SN to RN which is antipodal, remember. You see, antipodal points, they make sense on SN and they also make sense in RN, remember. In RN also, every point has an antipodal point. So, for any antipodal point mapping, continuous, there exists a point X in SN which goes to zero. This is the seventh version, and sometimes this version turns out to be very useful. Okay, I have now given you seven versions. There are people who have 10 versions, 15 versions of this theorem. But these seven versions I have chosen because I have seen applications of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem in one of these forms in my applications. So I wanted to tell you all these versions so that whenever somebody is using Bursu-Coulomb theorem, don't be surprised if he is going to use a particular form with which you may not be familiar. So remember that there are so many versions of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. Okay, here I want to emphasize that I have given you the seven statements and they are all equivalent. And each one of them is a Bursu-Coulomb theorem. Now, I hope you know that if you want to really understand a theorem and its importance, then you have to understand the proof of that theorem. Knowing only the statement and using just blindly is no use. Actually, that sometimes takes you into trouble also. So the proof is very important. And once you see the proof of all these equivalences, actually you'll be more knowledgeable about Bursu-Coulomb theorem, and you will never forget any one of these statements of the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. So see, I go back here. You have the first version, second version, third version, fourth version, fifth, sixth, seventh, and so on. And the question is, now I'm going to show you that these are all equivalent. Now, most of the time you want to prove the equivalence of so many statements as follows. You say that 1 implies 2, 2 implies 3, 3 implies 4, 4 implies 5, 5 implies 6, 6 implies 7, 7 implies 1. And the circle is complete and all of them are equivalent. That is how you do. But then you have to put them in the correct form, correct order, so that you can really prove that 1 implies 2, 2 implies 3, 3 implies 4, and so on. If you put them in some other order, that may be a difficult task to prove that in this sequence. Therefore, what I have done here in this particular situation, I prove that 1, 2, 3 are equivalent. This is what I'm going to prove. And then I prove that 3, 4, 5 are equivalent. And then you see, it proves that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they are all equivalent. Then I prove that 5 is equivalent to 6. I prove that 1 is equivalent to 6. And also 1 is equivalent to 7. And this proves that all of them are equivalent. This is just one way to understand these things, because actually the proofs are really very enlightening. That's why I'm going to give you some of these proofs, and you will really be very happy to know how the proofs go about. They go about only using the structure of the SN and the Z2 actions, that means antipodal maps, and only topology. No algebraic topology is involved in proving the equivalences of these. The algebraic topology is involved only in proving one of these statements, the main statement of Bursu-Coulomb theorem, namely, if you have a continuous mapping from SN to RN, then there exists a pair of points going to the same point. That is the main version of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, and you use algebraic topology in proving that version. Proving the equivalence of all these statements uses only topology, and you will enjoy them. Now, most proofs of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem use tools of algebraic topology, like degree of a map, the homotopy groups, the homology groups, homology-cohomology groups of a space, and the toroidal structure in cohomology. I am referring to my book and other books. And I must mention here that there is also a combinatorial proof of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, which uses Tucker's lemma, and Tucker's lemma is very famous. It's a combinatorial lemma, and it can be applied to prove the Borsuk-Ulam theorem in a combinatorial form. That is called the combinatorial proof of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem. Okay. Now, I want to tell you that things are simple. If you want to prove the equivalence of these, things are simple. And you can see the example right now, why these are simple. So the first proof itself will tell you that the proving equivalences are, sometimes you use topology, of course, but otherwise they are all very easy. Manipulation, you have only to manipulate things and that's it. The first thing that I want to prove is that one implies two. And remember, I recall, what is one? One is that there does not exist an antipodal preserving map from Sn to Sn minus 1. That is one. And what is two? Two is that given any continuous mapping from F from Sn to Rn, there exists a pair of points which go to the same point. And I want to prove that one implies two. And it is so easy. Suppose two is not true. What does it mean? This means if you take any pair of antipodal points, they go to different places. That means for all x in Sn, f of x is not equal to f of minus x. And therefore, you can define a mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1. The mapping is this, namely define map gx as f of x minus f of minus x, and you divide it by its norm, because you remember f of x is in Rn, so it's a vector. So f of x minus f of minus x divided by the norm of that vector, so it's a unit vector. And therefore, it lies on Sn minus 1. Therefore, this g is a well-defined mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1. And now you see that g is continuous, because f is continuous. And see, the g is antipodal, because g of minus x will be what? The numerator will change its sign. And you'll get that g of minus x is equal to minus g. Therefore, g is a antipodal preserving map from Sn to Sn minus 1. And that contradicts your one. Because one says that you cannot have a antipodal preserving map from g and from Sn to Sn minus 1. So it was so easy. I hope you realize my point. The proving the equivalences are not difficult. They are quite easy. Simple manipulations are involved, and sometimes topology is involved. So I have proved that one implies two. Now, see, here is topology involved. And you'll have to go with me. I'm going to go slowly so that you realize this is the Lusternik-Shellman theorem. What it says is that the Borsuk-Ulam theorem implies that if you take n plus 1 closed sets, f1, f2, fn plus 1, covering Sn, then at least one of them will contain a pair of antipodal points. That is the statement I have to prove. So I start with a covering. Let the covering be f1, f2, fn plus 1, and they are all closed. Remember that. And I am going to now prove that one of them will definitely contain a pair of antipodal points. So here is how it go. You define the distance function for each I. Now I is running from 1 to n. That means I am leaving fn plus 1 aside. I am not using that. I am defining only the distance function of point x from fi for all I running from 1 to n. So define this function, because fi is a closed set and you are in a sense it's a compact set. So this distance function is very well defined. And as you know, this is a continuous function. So you have now got n continuous functions from SN to real line. And therefore, you can define a map from SN to RN. And the definition is very easy. Define f of x simply the distance of x from f1, comma distance of x from x2, and similarly distance of x from fn. So now you have defined a mapping f from SN to RN. Remember, you are going towards Bursuq-Coulomb theorem now. So you define a mapping f from SN to RN by this formula, using all these n distance functions. And clearly, each one of them is continuous, therefore this is continuous by the product topology. And therefore, by 2, which is the Bursuq-Coulomb theorem, it says that there exists a pair of antipodal points which go to the same point. Therefore, what will happen? F of x naught, there will exist a point x naught, said that f of x naught is the same thing as f of minus x naught. And this means that distance of x naught from fi is the same thing as distance from minus x naught from fi for every I running from 1 to n. And now see the argument. Now, if x naught belongs to fi for some I, then because fi is closed, its distance is zero. Therefore, the distance of minus x naught is also zero, and so minus x naught also belongs to fi. And therefore, both x naught as well as minus x naught, they both belong to fi, and you are, and the theorem is proved, because then fi has a pair of antipodal points. If that is not true, that means if the distance of x naught from fi is not equal to distance of minus x naught from fi for any I running from 1 to n, then that this simply means that distance of x naught from fi will be positive for all I running from 1 to n, which means both the x naught as well as minus x naught, they will not be in fi. And if they will not be in fi, then that means they will not be in f1, they will not be in f2, they will not be in fn, but f1, f2 up to fn plus 1 is a cover. Therefore, they have to be fn plus 1. And you find that both x0 as well as minus x0, they are in fn plus 1, and the theorem is proved. I hope you realize the beauty of this theorem, how this has been proved. You are using simple topology, the distance function coming from metric spaces, and that's it, nothing more. And you have proved that 2 is equivalent to 3. Then 3 is equivalent to 1. Again, this is not difficult, and the method is same. If one is not true, then you will get a contradiction. So I'm not going to explain this, because this is actually a routine thing. You can think of inverses of all those FIs and can get a contradiction. So I leave this. Now, 3 implies 4. Now you remember what is 3, what is 4. So I go back to recall you so that there's no confusion. 3 and 4. Here is 3, here is 4. 3 is the Lusternik-Schliemann theorem for closed version, and 4 is the open version. So I am going to prove that the closed version of the Lusternik-Schliemann theorem implies the open version. Again, it is topology, nothing more than that. So I'm going to prove that 3 implies 4. So let's see. So I'm going to prove the open version of the Lusternik-Schliemann theorem. That means, given any n plus 1 open sets, U1, U2, UN plus 1, I have to prove that there exists at least one open set which contains a pair of integral points. This is what I have to prove. Now, you know that if you have a finite cover, you can always think of the Lebesgue number of discovering. Lebesgue number of discovering means for every x belonging to Sn, a closed ball Bx lambda can be found around x, which is contained in ui for some I. That is the definition of Lebesgue number, as most of you know. And Sn is compact, therefore you can find out the finite such balls Bx lambda, x belonging to Sn, covering Sn. And for each I, we choose all such balls which are contained in ui. And let Fi denote the union of such balls. Then Fi is obviously contained in ui for each I. And so, F1, F2, Fn, n plus 1 discovers Sn because U1, U2, U, n plus 1, they cover S. Hence, by 3, there exists an Fi, which is a pair of integral points. But that Fi is contained in Ui, therefore Ui contains a pair of integral points. Very easy proof. Okay, then we have 4 implies 5. Now, this actually uses the principle of induction besides topology, and I leave it for you. The induction starts from k is equal to 0. Actually, it says that if you consider any covering, g1, g2, gn plus 1, and assume that each one of these sets is either closed or open, then there exists one GI which contains a pair of integral points. And it's very easy using induction, and the definitions of GI, either they are open or they are closed, you can easily prove this theorem. The proof is given, and I'm not going to repeat this proof. But it is interesting. Okay, now this I want to do. Now, let me prove this. Two implies seven. Now, remember, two is the Borsuk-Ulam theorem, which says that any continuous mapping F from Sn to Rn has a pair of antipodal points going to the same point. And what is seven? The seven is that if F is a mapping from Sn to Rn, which is also antipodal, then there exists a point which goes to zero. And I say that 2 implies 7. Okay, so we start from here. By 2, we have a pair of antipodal points, x and minus x, so that f of x is equal to f of minus x. This is because of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. And since f is antipodal also, this is my assumption, therefore f of minus x is equal to minus f of x. And therefore, you find that 2 times f of x is 0. And that implies that f of x is 0. It is very simple. So from Borsuk-Ulam theorem, you can easily deduce that if you have a continuous mapping, and which is also antipodal from Sn to Rn, then there exists a point which goes to 0. A very beautiful theorem. Now, I want to tell you that 7 implies 1. Now, you see, this is very interesting. It is so trivial, you have only to follow. You have only to see what it says. 7 means what? Let me recall. I go back and tell you what 7 is, so that you are sure. 7. For any antipodal map from Sn to Rn, there exists a point x belonging to Sn so that f of x goes to 0. This is your 7. And I say that this implies, see, 7 says that any continuous mapping from Sn to Rn, there is a point which goes to 0. And I say that this really implies one. Now remember that F is a continuous mapping which is antipodal from Sn to Rn. Now notice, you have a continuous mapping from Sn to Rn. And remember, Rn contains Sn minus 1. Rn contains Sn minus 1 because Sn minus 1 is embedded in Rn. It is simply xn, so that sum of their squares is 1, which is sitting in Rn. So F, because it is antipodal mapping from Sn to Rn, this is really an antipodal mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1 also. So if there exists a point x which goes to 0, that contradicts the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, because I have got a continuous mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal preserving. You see, the very fact that F is antipodal from Sn to Rn implies that you have an antipodal preserving map from Sn to Rn minus 1. And this 7 says that there exists a x which goes to 0, but that contradicts the Bursu-Coulomb theorem, because you have a mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal preserving map. Therefore, 7 implies 1 also. There is one more thing which I have to discuss, and it is 6, because this is also very important. I have already explained this in my whiteboard, so again I'm going to use this. It is called antipodal on the boundary version. Antipodal on the boundary version. What it says, there is no continuous mapping from the disk, N disk, to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on the boundary. You remember I explained this. You cannot have a continuous mapping going from the N disk to its boundary Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on the boundary, Dn. You cannot have such a mapping. And here's a very interesting proof of this. So I will prove 6. And here is that proof. You see. One implies 6. Now remember, 6 says that you cannot have a continuous mapping Dn of G from Dn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on its boundary. You cannot have such a mapping. Now, if 6 is not true, that means you will have such a continuous mapping. So, suppose that G is that mapping, which is from Dn to Sn minus 1. Remember, it is antipodal on the boundary of Sn minus 1. This is where you have to be very careful. It's geometry. I am going to tell you what the geometry behind this. So, your assumption is this. There is a continuous mapping G from Dn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on the boundary of Sn minus 1 of Dn. And now, using this continuous mapping G, I can construct a mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1, which will be antipodal preserving, and that will contradict 1. And so, how we can construct such a mapping? So, what I'm giving is simply this, a mapping G from Dn to Sn minus 1. And here is the definition. So, look at this diagram here. You see the disk Dn, and you see the boundary Sn minus 1, that's the boundary, and you see the Sn. Sn is the whole thing, this N sphere. Now, there is a mapping G from Dn to the boundary Sn minus 1. So, there is a continuous mapping which is antipodal from Dn to Sn minus 1, and that mapping is G. And now, what I do, I define a mapping from Sn from Sn whole of Sn to Sn minus 1. And how do I do that? You take any point, and you remember, the upper hemisphere is nothing but it is homeomorphic to Dn. Therefore, you have a mapping H, which is a homeomorphism from the upper hemisphere to this N disk. So you take any point, apply H, come to Dn minus 1, then apply G, go to Sn minus 1. If you are doing this from upwards, this is what you do. But if you are doing from downwards, then you come to this Dn via this mapping H, but you take its negative and then you apply G. This will make sure that antipodal points on here, they go to the antipodal points on of Sn minus 1. And this will be a continuous mapping. And so here the definition which I showed to you, it's a very simple definition using this diagram. Here this definition, you define, you have this mapping G, which is antipodal on the boundary, and so you define a mapping F from Sn to Sn minus 1 as follows. Define F of H1 to Xn plus 1 as apply H on this, and you come to the disk, then apply G if the nth plus 1th coordinate is positive, greater than or equal to 0, and take its negative if it is less than or equal to 0. So that will ensure that all the antipodal points of Sn, they go to the antipodal points of Sn minus 1. And therefore, you have a continuous mapping from Sn to Sn minus 1, preserving antipodal points, and that contradicts the first version of the Orsi-Coulomb theorem. Very nice. So what is here involved? Nothing more than simple topology and the fact that the upper hemisphere is homeomorphic to the N disk. That's all. Nothing much. So what I'm emphasizing is that I have given you 7 versions of the Orsi-Coulomb theorem. And they are all very revealing in the sense that really tell you the beauty of the Orsi-Coulomb theorem and the equivalence, proving the equivalence of these theorems is not difficult. It uses only simple topology with which you are familiar. But proving any one of them, that means proving the Orsi-Coulomb theorem is difficult. And it is not easy because it uses real tools of algebraic topology. There one has to be well versed with the cohomology algebra of the real projective spaces to get a proof of this. And the proof is by method of contradiction. Okay, so I have now explained you, and I think you have got something. The only thing was that my handwriting was not very good. Otherwise, I could have drawn a diagram to explain you, but I hope you got what I wanted to say. So I have given you the 7 versions of the Orsi-Coulomb theorem, and I repeat, all of them are very important, and all of them are highly geometric. Remember, if you understand the Euclidean n-space, if you understand the round n-sphere, then you understand the statement of the Orsi-Coulomb theorem very well. And of course, the main point is antipodal points. The idea of antipodal points, that is crucial in all these results. Now, here is one thing, that is the last thing I want to mention now. And this is the following. I have told you Orsi-Coulomb theorem. I have given you its several forms. And I also mentioned in the very beginning, the Drummond's fixed point theorem. That was also associated with continuous maps from Dn to Dn. Orsi-Coulomb theorem is associated with continuous maps from Sn to Rn. And the Drummond's fixed point theorem is concerned with self-map from N disk to itself. And it says that it has a fixed point. And as I told you, both are very important theorems of algebraic topology. And you'll be surprised to know that the Orsi-Coulomb theorem is stronger. What does it mean? This simply means that the Orsi-Coulomb theorem implies the Drummond's fixed point theorem. And it is not known even today whether the converse is true or not. So it's very interesting, and I want to explain you, because this explanation is very easy. So I want to explain you how Orsi-Coulomb theorem implies Drummond's fixed point theorem. So see here. This is the theorem, and it's five-line proof. The Bursu-Coulomb theorem implies the Brouwer six-point theorem. Okay, so I'm going to prove this now. So, try to follow each sentence that I read here. Let Dn be a n-disk and F be a continuous map from Dn to Dn. And I want to show that it has a fixed point. Suppose it does not have a fixed point. Then this is what you do. I have to go to whiteboard. So just a second, please. So here is this. This is my Sn minus 1. And this is Dn. Now you have a mapping F from Dn to Dn. You have a mapping F from Dn to Dn. And I want to say that this has a fixed point. Okay. Suppose it does not have a fixed point. That means what? That means you take any x, and f of x will be different from x. F of x will be different from x. So just let me erase this and make it more clear. So you have a mapping f. You have a mapping f from Dn to Dn. Suppose this does not have a fixed point. What does it mean? This means if you take any point x here, then fx is here. X and fx have to be different. So what I ask you to do is the following. From fx, you draw a straight line and produce it. And you come to Sn minus 1 here. You have come to Sn minus 1. So you take fx, join 2x, and draw this line segment, and suppose it meets here, and call this mapping as, say, g of x. So this is my x, and this is your f of x. So I have defined now a mapping g of x, g, from the n disk. So this g is therefore a mapping from dn to Sn minus 1. To the boundary. This is Sn minus 1. Now, image of x is here gx, because this is how I have defined. What you do, you take x, you take fx, join fx to x, and come to the boundary, and you get g of x. So I ask you now, what is the image of this point? Answer is, take its image. So wherever this image will be, and then join this with this, and extend it where it meets, that is the point. So that means this point goes to itself under the mapping G. So using this construction, which I have just explained to you, I have now defined a mapping G from Dn to Sn minus 1, which fixes every point of Sn minus 1. Therefore, you have got a mapping from F from Dn to Sn minus 1, which is identity on Sn minus 1. And remember, identity mapping is anti-Poulle preserving map. Therefore, you have got a continuous mapping G from Dn to Sn minus 1, which is anti-Poulle preserving on the boundary. And that contradicts the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. Therefore, my assumption that F does not have a fixed point must be wrong. And so, F must have a fixed point, and you have proved the Bursu-Coulomb theorem. So, this is what I have written. I have explained to you. Suppose F has no fixed point. Then we can define a mapping G from Dn to Sn minus 1 as follows. For any X belonging to Dn, draw the line segment joining Fx to Fx. And this construction is very important.
and produce the line segment so that it meets the boundary sum minus 1 of n in a unique point, say, g of x. Then notice that g is a continuous map and it is identity on SN. And since the identity map is antipodal, we conclude that the Bersu-Coulomb theorem is not true. And that is a contradiction. Therefore, Bersu-Coulomb theorem implies the Brouwer's expansion. And it is very interesting to ask the converse whether it is true or not. I asked many algebraic topologists, but so far nobody has given me an answer, and looks like this is an open problem. It was also published in the Mathematics Student as an open problem. So nobody has given so far whether the converse is true or not. If the converse is true, one has to prove it. But if the converse is not true, one has to give a counterexample. And nothing has come so far. So I think this is all. I want to now come to an end. And this is the book which I was referring to, Algebraic Topology Primer. This is Hindustan Book Agency, Trim Series number 27. It has a very nice, very elementary proof of Bersu-Coulomb theorem. If you are interested, you might like to go through that. So that's all. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much, sir, for your very illuminating and prudent lecture, I should say that. And I think Professor D.K. Ganguly has already joined. So can you conclude, sir, please?
Professor Satyado, how are you?
Professor Ganguly?
Yeah.
Okay, I was remembering you in the start of my lecture.
Because I was little bit late, because I was misled. Right now, you are in Delhi or Allahabad?
No, I'm in Allahabad. I cannot go to Delhi because of this corona. I'm confined to my home only. And it was good that you organized this conference so that I am at my home and I can lecture from here.
But you have to take the dialysis. But it is completed right now. You are okay?
I'm okay. It is actually on 3 days. 3 days. So today is a free day. And on 3 days, I am okay. I am normal.
Oh, that is very good. Very good.
So it is all because of the you people, your blessings and so on. So I am doing fine.
Yeah, yeah. Everybody,
I can participate. You. Yes, I can participate.
That's very nice. Nice to hear from you. How about Khatre? Khatre
is fine. Khare. Yeah, he is in Allahabad.
Yeah,
okay.
I know that.
Yeah. He's also doing okay? Fine. Yes, he's okay. No problems.
Okay. So I am very much pleased that you have give your consent to give a lecture on this audience. It's a very nice lecture.
And I'm very happy that you invited me to the program.
Because last time when you came to the Department of Pure Mathematics, my peer, I think 2019, you came to the
Department
of
Pure Mathematics. Yes.
I talked to her phone.